speaker this morning is Dr. Yeah, Doctor. Pretty good. I made you a doctor. Aren't you excited? Doctor of soul. Anyway, so Captain Guy Gruters. Now, about a year and a half ago, I was doing a men's conference up in Boise, Idaho. And while I was there, also Captain Gruters was there with me. And I just sat there as he was speaking. And you will hear, he'll show some video and he'll talk about his experience. I just sat there like, really? I was completely dumbfounded by what this man went through. And so, you know, I wrote a book called Be a Man. I don't know if you knew that. But I got up and I sat there and says, I was not the one that should have wrote the book Be a Man. He should have wrote the book How to Be a Man. Because of anyone I've met, he's truly a man who lives masculinity. What he's went through and how he comes in his deep faith in Jesus. So gentlemen, I want you to sit there and give a warm welcome to our first speaker, Captain Guy Gruters. Doctor.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you.
Hail Mary, our Father.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I started out in South Vietnam supporting the 173rd Airborne Brigade. And this was 4,500 airborne troops, spectacular U.S. soldiers. And I was a forward air controller for them, putting in airstrikes next to them like the artillery, forward air observers did for the artillery. You have a man here called Chat, who was one of those forward observers for artillery that was with the 173rd the same time that I was. In the Dokto Special Forces camp, it was a tent camp for us. And we had daily mass in one of the tents. We were there for 3 months of the monsoon season where the mud was literally up to your knees. The priest would wade in that mud
each day to that tent, and we did too. And he'd give us daily mass, and he'd give us daily absolution. So I had never any trouble with combat. I had no fear at all because I had daily mass and daily confession. Now this mass every day, I've kept it up my whole life through 7 kids, many jobs, and so on and so forth. A lot of troubles down here. This is a testing life to test us to see where he wants to puts us in heaven, what level he's going to put us in heaven. So every day I'd go to daily mass, and he let me get through the day. He let me get through another day in peace, calm, and happy. Happy with all the troubles of life, because I knew that he was in charge. I put my life in his hands. So lets me pray very well in the morning for an hour or two. I get very close to God and Mary and the saints and the angels because I pray every day, and I have very great confidence that they're with me all throughout the day. I try to pray throughout the day and so on. This quote down at the bottom, courage is fear that has said its prayers. I submit that that's a good philosophy for every day. We need courage to get through every day. It's not easy down here. After I was shot down and captured, I ended up in the communist prison system of North Vietnam. I'll be talking a little bit about the solitude, the torture, and the living conditions. First of all, the solitude. They kept us isolated in 1- and 2-man cells, and this was a real fanatic job they did. As an example, we had buckets for our bathroom. Each day the guard would start down the line of the 50 cells in the first camp I was in. I was in 6 different camps. And he would take the bar off the door, open the door, nod to the POW. The POW put his bucket out. He'd close the door, put the bar back down. He did that 50 individual cells. Then one of the cells was let out with 2 POWs, picked up the 50 buckets, brought them to an old French latrine, a hole in the ground, dumped the 50 buckets, put the empty buckets in front of the 50 cells. Then the guard would go down one at a time. We weren't allowed to see or talk to another American to keep us easy to manipulate, easy to get military information from, easy to use us for their propaganda. This is typical communist prison camps. They do it everywhere in the world. It's to break you down, have you as an individual. You can't fight as a team and so on. Also with that went no letters for the first 2.5 years, no way to tell your wife you're alive, no letters from her to tell you. They're telling you constantly that your wife has left you and she's married someone else. All this kind of thing is constantly going on. In solitude, we were by ourselves. There's no books, there's no radio, there's no electricity, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You're by yourself, dead quiet, most of the day and most of the night. You're only allowed to whisper when you do whisper to your cellmate if you have one. Okay, let's look at solitude. Solitude is consistently said to be divine. Remember, Jesus sought solitude every morning. Most are kept from God, Satan's greatest attack on each of us is to keep us busy with ridiculous pursuits like books that aren't religious, movies that aren't religious, etc., conversations that aren't religious, etc., etc. And we've wasted our life. And when we die, we may still get to heaven if we've learned to obey and be sorry for breaking any of the Ten Commandments. We may still get to heaven, but we'll have regrets for trillions of years that we didn't work on our spiritual life when we had the chance down here. That level is set at death on judgment and never changes for trillions of years. And when you read about the saints that have been to heaven and back, they tell you over and over again, the most important thing to do down here is work on spiritual life, because otherwise the level will never be increased forever. Now, as far as the torture is concerned, one of the easiest tortures was the little metal bracelets on your wrist. And you can still eat. You have bread and water twice a day. You can still eat with those braces on your wrist. They call them manacles. The irons tightly hold your wrist together. You can drink with it. They'd let you drink twice a day. But you couldn't wipe yourself. So you have your filth. You're sitting in your filth, laying in your filth. It's very uncomfortable. You're in pain all the time. You can't sleep good and so on and so forth. This gets old after a day or two. It's really bad after a week, a month, and so on. This was one of their little punishment tortures. In the middle, you see a guard effectively kicking a POW in a broken arm. We had combat chutes and fighters come down very fast, broke a lot of arm and legs. The guards would, about 30-40% of them would love to kick you in them or hit you in the groin or whatever by surprise and just cause extreme pain. By the way, the guards, when they first came there, wouldn't do this. The guards, when they first came there, were a lot like the people in this room. But after 3 months of absolute power, some of them became very vicious and cruel. So I just throw that out as a warning. What I learned was that you've got to be careful when you have power, because you can really learn to abuse the power over the people that have no recourse against you. On the right-hand side, beatings to death. They beat you with these heavy rubber truncheons. They don't open up all the skin of the back and the buttocks area, and they pour salt on the wounds. You heard salt on the wounds. They do that 3 or 4 times a day. The average POW would last about 2 months before he died. One guy lasted 6 months. Most common torches, the one on the upper right, they tie your elbows touching behind your back, and then they take a rope from that. It takes 5 guys to get your elbows touching. Dislocates one of your shoulders. Your elbows are touching. They take a rope from your elbows over your shoulders, around ankle irons, and hike it up until you see you're in a position like this with your elbows stretched back over your shoulders. And it's extremely painful. It's like having an abscess tooth in your entire body. And they tie it, and then this torture doesn't have to do any work. It just watches you in agony. Twice a day, they loosen it up and let you eat, because they don't want to kill you. They just want to keep you in agony. They do that 24/7. Torture is not 8 hours a day. Then you go home and watch television. Torture is 24 hours. It goes on day after day, 24/7. If you still didn't do something like meet the delegations, they'd effectively take a rope from your elbows, hang you from a fan hook, beat you on the bony parts of your body every hour on the hour, about 18 cycles a day, day after day after day, let you down twice a day to eat. But, you know, basically extremely powerful torture. And I never saw anybody last more than 13 days and nights in that torture. I wrote just a few notes on each of these things. Solitude, I talked about, you know, solitude is divine. Instead of being sorry for solitude and having quiet, then you should be happy for it. Torture is the same way. I was ignorant at that time. I was 24 years old. I didn't understand. But after reading the saints and the spiritual lessons of the saints, I say, although I was ignorant, now I realize I should have accepted these trials as a good reparation suffering. God allows or causes others to torture us in many ways, verbally and by what they cause to happen in our life. Every day, we're all tortured in some little ways by other people. The important thing to know is that I didn't learn until prison camp is that God is totally in charge of every detail in life. This includes our crosses. This includes when people hurt us. God has allowed that. Okay, so we need some help here. We need some crosses. We need some help. We're not as perfect as we all seem to think we are. We need a little help here. So he gives us help. So we shouldn't get mad at the instrument that hurts us. It's not fair. They don't even realize that they're being used by God to discipline us. So we should accept the cross. We should unite it to the cross of Christ, and we should be at peace. All crosses, every single one, save us from our sinful nature. They're all for our benefit. He loves each of us perfectly. The Trinity is in everybody. He's right here in us. He's always in us, even if we're a sinner. He's not in us the same way as he is when we are in a state of grace, but he's still with us. There's nothing out of his control. The key to crosses is to accept them with joy and a smile and resignation to God's will. Do the best we can, but not worry about it. Okay, is there any resolution? Now I'm coming back to a torture slide. Is there any way to switch the input to a PC on this thing? Okay. Okay, living conditions. The food that we had was bread and water twice a day, the first 2.5 years. Little loaves of bread like this. They were full of hundreds of rat droppings each. They had all kinds of worms in them. A lot of the worms were living worms. Some of them were dead, but a lot of them were living. There was mold on the bread. We'd bite into the bread sometimes. The worms would bite us in our mouth. The water had thousands of little worms in it. They were dead because they boiled the water, but you could see the worms. They're just big enough to see. We drank that. We ate all that rat excrement from the bread because there was no way to eat the bread without it. You couldn't, if you dug the rat excrement out, you wouldn't have anything to eat and you'd die. But we had to eat the bread and drink the water. No other conditions, no other water in the room. You never could wash your hands or anything like that. We had a bucket for the bathroom. We had one piece of 8.5 by 11, quote, toilet paper, unquote, a month. It was a very rough brown toilet paper with knots still in the paper. We had two guys with diarrhea. Two of us had diarrhea for the first 2.5 years. As a result, you didn't have enough toilet paper, of course, so we have to use our hands, standard, to wipe ourselves. Right on the walls, because the floors were so bad, we were only allowed to clean the floors of the cell one time in 5 years. So because of the filth, and we had to eat the bread with our hands, couldn't get the poop out of your nails, even off your hands, you're just wiping on concrete. So you get all kinds of parasites after a year, 2-3 years. To give you an idea, this was, you know, there's all kinds of parasites you get, but we have tapeworm contest. You know, how long is your tapeworm? You know, 22 feet, 23 feet, 25 feet. I was in a cell that had a guy with the longest one that I knew of, which was 32 feet, so then you tap that through the walls, so proud that you've got the longest tapeworm. Somebody in your cell, this is a big deal. You know, men, luckily there weren't any lovely ladies there, so we could have contests like that. I'm talking to my commanding officer after 3 years. He coughs, and about 4 inches of a big worm comes out of his mouth. I say, Al, something's coming out of there. So I pull the worm, it's a 12-inch worm, big, thick thing. Looks like a fishing worm, but it's a interior worm. He's still coughing. I say, tip your throat, maybe there's more down there. Within 15 minutes, I have a dozen of these things in my hand. I'm holding them by their body. The ends are weaving around in the air. They're still alive. I say, that's good, Al. That's good. Got them out of there. Meanwhile, I'm thinking in my mind, Lord, how do we handle this? They're eating us from the inside out. There's just nothing we can do. But I don't say that, because I'd learned by then, you don't complain. I'd read a lot of books in the military situations and wars, And they always said that when it really gets bad, a unit doesn't dare complain. I always wondered, why would they not complain? I found out in North Vietnam, sometimes you'd complain and a guy would stop eating, commit suicide. Couldn't handle it anymore. Everybody's hanging on by their fingertips. Just got a little heart left. You complain, you rip out the little heart. It looked like we'd never get out of there. It wasn't a 5-year thing. It looked like a lifetime thing. So guys would just quit. We had 3,500 guys shot down and not rescued. 472 came out. 1 in 6 came out. 1 in 7 came out. And the others were tortured to death or killed in one way or the other by the North Vietnamese and the Russians. However, there were some men that committed suicide because of complaints, generally, through the wall. So I say you cut out the last little heart of somebody hanging on, but you do the same with your wife, your kids, your parents, your team members, your business, anything. When you complain, you tear a little heart out of your compatriot that you're complaining to. So the deal is, don't complain. This is why being positive is a virtue. Always positive, never negative. That's the way it should be. The temperatures in the wintertime were in the 30s and 40s. We had one thin blanket. We had two pairs of pajamas. Thin pajamas. We wore everything in the wintertime. We'd have 5 and 10 days of shivering constantly. Never stopped shivering day and night. In the summertime, we'd have bleeding heat rash by the May. We have no ventilation, no windows in these cells. These are concrete cells with tin roof on top of them. And we'd have tremendous temperatures in those cells. We'd spend all the time we could on the concrete floor, breathing the air from underneath the door, the crack under the door, to get 100 degree air. Okay, it was terrible. We'd have the bleeding heat rash again by the end of May, and then we had the hot months, June, July, and August. So the regular living conditions were just beyond anything that we'd ever dreamed of. And I say here, commenting on that, we were in absolute poverty. I say poverty is a virtue because we really do crave comfort. We crave ease, everything easy. We want everything to be easy. I learned we can live simply and humbly and still be very close to God. We have to live a clean and sanitary life, of course. We need things to live and be healthy, of course, and for our families. We have to work, we have to provide good things. But the focus on stuff and materialism and the nicest car in the neighborhood and all this kind of stuff and all this stuff that's not necessary is a serious sin. I found out there's great freedom in having little, just enough to what you need to live. I wasn't distracted by things. I didn't have to care for anything. I had nothing. It resulted in being able to draw close to God for the first time in my life. So the solitude, the torture, and the living conditions were the greatest thing that ever happened to me. The prison experience was the greatest thing that ever happened to me. Because I knew in my late 20s that God was infinitely powerful everywhere. When I first got up there, I didn't think God was up there. It was so bad. But I found out, he revealed himself to me. I found out that he's infinitely in charge. Please believe me, there is no coincidence on earth, and no one gets away with anything, including me. Or you, or anyone, and we all make mistakes every day, and we don't get away with any mistake we make. We got to try to do the best thing, the right thing all the time, but understand, we're constantly being taught, we're in school, the teacher's very quiet, God's very quiet, he gives us free will, but he's constantly testing us every day, hundreds of times. Are we going to do the right thing, or are we going to do the selfish thing? So I learned that in prison camp in my late 20s, versus dying of cancer at 70 or 80, like, you know, I'm an old man now. At least I knew in my life that God was in charge. Now I talk a little bit about communication. It's vital to planning. We had to fight as a team. We did fight as a team. We fought with the code of conduct. We beat the communists in North Vietnam with no physical force. We beat them by discipline. We beat them by communication. We beat them by trusting in God above all. It was a God-based resistance from the beginning because of our commander, and because of that God-based resistance, we won against the communists in North Vietnam, which all of us thought was impossible, but we did by prayer. Now, how did we communicate? Well, there is a 26-digit alphabet, but we made it 25 digits. So now there's just five rows, five columns, A, B, C, D, E across the top, F, G, H, I, J, then L, M, N, O, P, no K. If you need a K, you use C. So now I can tap out any word with row-column communication. For example, on the second row, I've got A, B, C, D, E across the top, and I got F, G, H, I, J. So H is second row, third column. I is second row, fourth column. So if I want to tap out high, I can tap out 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. I pause after each word, and the guy on the wall on the other side, he has his ear up against the wall. I have my ear up against the wall. Very, very light taps, because they're constantly got guys trying to catch you. It's many weeks of torture if they catch you communicating. When he understands a word, he goes. If he doesn't understand, he goes. And I recommunicate. Then he says, okay, I got it. Next word, I start typing because. He understands it's because from context. He goes. So it's texting one word at a time. Abbreviations come in. It's just, it gets very fast. It basically, it let us organize and be a team. And we had the code of conduct to tell us who was in charge in each cell, in each cell block, in each prison camp. We followed the code of conduct. We had leadership. We had team members. We followed single orders. We had order in that camp. And so we were able to fight as a team and beat the communists. Now, at the end of that communication session, in six different camps, every time, all the time, every session, and there were many sessions, each cell to cell, and you're talking hundreds or maybe thousands in a camp. Okay, each session was ended with, if we had time, which generally we did, because the guys would pound on the wall when the guard was seen. Everybody, half the guys were on their knees looking out the crack under the door, monitoring the guards coming to catch us, communicating. And they'd pound the wall, and then we'd get off the wall until the situation was all clear. But at any rate, we'd always sign off. Two, two, that's G for God. One, one, two, that's B for bless. A is one, one, God bless America, okay? Or if we had time, it would be GBU, God bless you. Every communication, every camp, okay? Now, when I first got up there, as I mentioned, I didn't realize that God was up there. I thought it's too evil, vicious, too horrible, too filthy, too everything. No way in the world that God would be in that filth. It was not fair. That's what I thought in my mind. I wasn't praying. I was just thinking that. I was a cradle Catholic. I was going to daily mass. But I believe that God was out in the distance. I didn't realize that he's in me. I didn't realize that he's controlling every detail, period, that my body sees, that everybody's body sees, that everybody's mind sees, that everybody's soul sees. I didn't understand he's infinite. He is really infinite, okay? I didn't understand that. So I thought, well, he's not up here. So my lousy belief in God was that when things are really tough, what does God do? He gets out of there. He gets out of there. Within a year, I understood what I'm talking about. He was infinite. He was right there in prison camp. And it was totally in control of the communists as well as us and everybody else. Nothing to worry about. At any rate, this conversion took time. The conversion was as a result of being alone there and of all things observing nature. The nature was the ants and the spiders and the ants and the spider fights, the geckos, I had on the top vent of the cell, I had a single leaf I could see in the sunlight, a leaf, one single leaf of a tree, which was infinitely beautiful. I'd spend hours staring at that leaf in the sunlight, okay? And it brought me close to God. For the first time in my life, I really had time to think instead of always doing things and so on and so forth. Now, at the problem was with those first months is that I had plenty of pride as a fighter pilot. I was being abused badly. We were being beat up really bad by the guards all the time. We were being tortured. They killed one of my good friends up there, tortured him to death in about a month with beatings. So I became very angry. Pride leads to anger. Anger leads to hatred. First time in my life, I got into very bad, serious hatred. It got worse through the months. I started thinking of all kinds of ways to torture them. If I ever got out, come back and kidnap them and kill them slowly. See how they liked it, okay? Terrible hatred, real hatred. Thanks be to God, I don't think many people get in hatred that bad. But I was in horrible hatred. All of a sudden, I start getting voices telling me that the way to beat these guys, the communists, is to go over in the corner and stop eating, just like guys were doing. So I said, whoa. Luckily, I'd been to a Catholic parochial school for a few years, and we had Sister Thomas Ann beat into the end of our heads with the edge of a yardstick Catholic truths. One of the Catholic truths is that suicide is not allowed. And the way she said it is that you're a coward and a quitter. You'll always be a coward and a quitter. Your eulogy will be, here lies a coward, here lies a quitter. But she said it's worse than that. You make your whole family a suicide family. That is your mother, your father, your aunts and uncles, your brothers, your sisters, anybody. Anybody associated with you is going to be the suicide family, the coward, the quitter family. That's what they're going to be because of you, because you're such a baby. You can't handle life. It gets tough and you commit suicide. So don't ever do it. You might also go to hell. So she said it strong enough that I never forgot it. So now when I got these voices telling me to commit suicide, I knew that can't be from God. He wouldn't do that. Must be from the devil. Why would the devil be talking to me? I'm an American fighting for my country. I'm not doing anything wrong. But I was. I was in the worst sin of all, hatred of one of God's, of a number of God's children. Hatred, real hatred of his children. Hating God's children. That's what I was. That's the worst sin. God is love, Satan is hate. But I saw that. Why did I see that? Because of the grace of God. Because, you know, sin blinds, and a lot of times you don't see it. But I saw it. And then sin blinds, and then it basically enslaves, and I was a slave now to hatred. I couldn't stop thinking of hatred. And then it leads to pain and suffering and death. That's what the Catholic Church teaching is. And you always got to go with the Catholic Church teaching. Remember, the greatest thing about the Catholic Church is it's right whether you believe it or not. The greatest thing about the Catholic Church is it's right whether you believe it or not. So don't screw around. Don't doubt. It's right. There's no doubt of it. That's the only church in the world you can say that about. Some of them have some of the truth, but only the Catholic Church is right whether you believe it or not. Okay, now why did I have the grace to see through the blindness of this terrible sin? Because when I was first shot down, my mother and my aunt made a pact to say the rosary in church every day if God would bring me back until the day they died. And they did say that rosary every day till the day they died, and they're both dead now. And because of that, I believe I had the grace to see that I was in suicide mode because of hatred, and that hatred itself was a sin. So I saw that, and so I said, oh my gosh, you don't mean, in my mind I was thinking, God, are you telling me that I gotta forgive these people? And in my mind I thought, that's impossible. But there was dead silence in my mind, and I realized I had to forgive them. So I said, okay, well, I'll forgive them. Me, tough, 25 years old, I'll forgive them. But I couldn't forgive them. The voices got stronger and stronger. I am a slave to sin. So I got on my knees. I couldn't stop. It was horrible. I couldn't sleep at night. All I could do was think of ways of torturing these people. I said, Jesus, you've got to help me. I can't do it. I can't change. I can't stop hating them. Please help me. Please help me. You're the Savior. Please save me from this. Please, please help me. And I prayed the rosary, and I didn't even know the stations, or I didn't know the mysteries or anything. I didn't know even one mystery. All I knew, it was 10 Hail Marys and one Our Father, so I'd say 15 decades a number of times a day. And I prayed and prayed and prayed. I had no priest, I had no confession, had no mass, had no nothing. I just prayed all the time. After 3 months, I remember thinking, being able to say for the first time in my mind, if you can imagine hatred like that, for the first time after 3 months, I said, Lord, forgive him, but I didn't mean it. After 3 months of prayer, I still didn't mean it. But after 6 months of prayer, I did mean it. And I was praying, Lord, please help them. I understand they're your children. I want them to go to heaven. I forgive them, Lord. I'm praying for them, Lord. Please, let them see. Let them go to heaven. Let them be sorry and go to heaven. Please. So the last 3.5 years, it took about a year, year and a half. The last 3.5 years of prison camp, I had the greatest peace and joy of my entire life because I knew that God was in charge. That if he wanted us home the next day, his power was literally infinite. If he wanted us out of there the next day, we'd be out of there the next day, no matter what the communists said, no matter what anybody said. If he wanted us to stay there for the rest of our lives, we'd be there the rest of our lives, and that was fine because he knew what he was doing, okay? And so it was on him. It's on him, not on me anymore. So I was very happy. I was very joyful. I wasn't worried about a thing. That's what he does for you when you realize that he's in charge. The life down here becomes joy, even in tough times, and we were in very, very tough times here. Now, the lesson was, is to have a bad habit forgiven and stopped where you can change. You can't rely on yourself, okay? You've got to rely on Jesus Christ. That's why he came. There really are devils out there, and they really do enslave us to sin. So, to stop a bad habit, when you know you got a bad habit, this can be any bad habit, any sin, when you do it repeatedly, it becomes a bad habit, you're blind to it, it enslaves you, leads to pain and suffering, and if you still don't stop, death, and that's spiritual death. You really get in trouble here. So basically, to stop that habit, you got to go to God. Well, when I got back, I had trouble with drinking and smoking. And this time, though, I had confession. So, it's like the hatred. I didn't want to stop smoking. I didn't want to stop drinking. I don't want to stop. I want to do it. I enjoy the pleasure. There's a great hatred in pleasure. There's a great pleasure in hatred, rather, and there's a great pleasure in smoking, and there's a great pleasure in drinking. I don't want to stop, but I go to confession, and I confess it. And I go every week, and after 5 weeks, he did the same, 4 or 5 weeks, he did the same thing for each of those that he did for my hatred in 6 months. And what happened was is that I've never smoked since, I've never drank since, and in all cases, I have no desire to drink. I don't want to drink, and I don't want to smoke. Well, it's been easy. Why? Because Jesus Christ is in charge of our wants and desires, and he can convert our heart from wanting to do a sin to not wanting to do a sin. I can't say enough. Confession is the way out of any bad habit. You just gotta confess it, and God will give you the grace. That's the tremendous truth of confession. It's so wonderful. So at any rate, now I use confession. I don't have hopefully mortal sins that I know of anymore, which, you know, that could be yes or no, but I have a lot of venial sins, so I do the same thing. I try to confess my venial sins, and one at a time. You know, there's over 100 good habits, 100 virtues, over 100 of them, over 100 of them. And I still have a lot of bad habits, and I'm working now on the littler sins. That's what I'm trying to work on with confession, and it works. He constantly takes one at a time and makes it where I don't want to be a jerk anymore that way. So, at any rate, can't say enough about God's, when he says, when you say Jesus Christ, Savior, that's exactly what he is. And what the church says is exactly right. He and he alone can save us from the enslavement of the sin. Okay? Now, our leader was Robbie Reisner. The first communication we got by the tap code from Robbie Reisner was, look, we're all Americans, and God is our trust. So I want you all to pray with me heavy every day. But on Sunday, when they sound their gong for siesta, we'll have our church service, the Our Father, 23rd Psalm, and the Pledge of Allegiance. So I want you to pray that with me, and then you'll know in solo or torture that you're praying with everybody else up here. That'll be our church service. Who is Robbie Reisner? Robbie Reisner was from Oklahoma. In World War II, he was a son of a sharecropper, poor family, wanted to be a minister, wanted to be a Protestant minister, and he was going to be one. He'd been accepted to Bible school and everything. And then war broke out. He said, well, maybe the Lord wants me to fight. So he put in an application for Air Force pilot. He passed it by one point. He took that as an indication he was supposed to be a pilot. So he was a fighter pilot in World War II for 2.5 years. Then he was a fighter pilot in Korea. He had eight kills of MiGs in Korea. But his crowning achievement was commander of the POWs in North Vietnam in a successful Jesus Christ-led resistance for 7.5 years. He was 5.5 years under torture and never, ever let it get him down. And he inspired us for all those years to resist with the code of conduct exactly according to the way it was written, our orders, and don't compromise in any way. Don't take any favors from him. If we have to live our life up here, his motto was, is that when we go home, we want to return with honor to the United States if we live. Now, there's two things can happen to us. We either die here with honor, or we go home with honor. Doesn't really matter. All we care about is what God thinks of us. Our job is to obey our orders, support each other, love our country, love our God. That's all we have to do. And that's what he put through the walls, and we bought into that, and it was a completely God-based resistance. We had no hope of getting out of there. It looked like a lifetime up there. Now, when we got into the big cells, the big dungeons, 40, 45 men, this happened after about 3 years or so. After 3 years, there were very brave men of the United States that came in to try to rescue the POWs because of all the ruckus that our wives had raised, our POW wives had raised in the United States. They talked to all the civic groups. They talked to the politicians. They said, these guys are being tortured badly. You got to get them out of there. So they sent a Sante raid, our special ops people, to Sante. There were 50 POWs there, but they'd been moved. They killed all the guards. They didn't get any POWs. They thought it was a failure. But it wasn't a failure. It was the most successful POW raid in the history of the world because it made the North Vietnamese take us from overall about 8 or 9 different camps and consolidate us into the Hanoi Hilton in 7 big dungeons. There was about 300 of us alive, 310 or whatever, out of 2,000 that had been shot down at that time. And the 300 of us were in these dungeons then of about 40 to 50 people, 40 to 50 Americans. Now instead of one American or two Americans, you're in cells with 40 to 50 other American pilots. It was heaven on earth compared to what those solo cells were like. It was heaven on earth. They also, because of the ruckus back in the States, Americans writing letters to the delegation in Paris, the North Vietnamese delegation in Paris. One time they had 11 million letters from American citizens delivered and 2 18-wheelers dumped on the street because they wouldn't accept them out in front of the North Vietnamese embassy. They started feeding us bread. We were probably all down to about 120, 130 pounds by that time. But in the last couple of years, we got 30, 40 pounds back. I came out at about 160, 165. And because they fed us all that bread for those last extra bread for the last 2 years, all because of the Sante raid and the support of the American people, prayer and every other way for the POWs up there. When we first got in those dungeons, Reisner's first order through the walls, now we're right next to each other, it's real easy to get communication. He said, all right, this time we'll have a church service for 2 hours on Sunday, starting at the same gong. We'll have an hour of songs. We'll start with Battle Hymn of the Republic, Amazing Grace, and listed 11 hymns. And then we'll have each room will vote a chaplain in, and the chaplain will assign people to read various Bible stories who are good on them for the second hour. The trouble with that is that you've got a rule of silence in a communist prison camp. Again, torture if they even hear you whispering to your cellmate. So at 12 noon on Sunday, we all belted out the Battle Hymn of the Republic at the top of our voice, 300 POWs. They came in with machine guns and took the leadership out and put them in the torture rooms. Next guy in date of rank order stood up and said, gentlemen, they interrupted our service. A Let's start again. We started again with the battle hymn of the Republic. But he came in, took those leaders out, put them in the torture rooms. This went on and on until all the torture rooms are filled. Next leader in data rank order stood up and said, "Gentlemen, they interrupted our service. Start again with the battle hymn of the Republic." And we started again. This time we finished a two-hour service. The next day was my turn to monitor interrogations. An Ohio guy, Ed Meckenbier, was brought into the camp commander to be given a riot act on his church service. And I heard the conversation, my ears on the concrete floor. You can hear the building next door. You can hear conversations next door with your ear on the ground like that. So I heard every word. The commander of the camp said, "We will not allow church services. No church services. You know that. It's against the regulation. We have a rule of silence. You've embarrassed us in front of our Russian allies. There will be no more. We will torture and kill to stop this service." And Meckenbier said to him just like this, he said, "You can torture and kill every one of us, but as long as one man's alive, we're having that service." And that's exactly the way we felt. We meant it. They knew we meant it. They didn't want to kill the last 300 guys they haven't killed. They wanted us for bargaining chips probably or something. Anyway, they let us have that service. So we had that service. That was Reisner. One of the things that happened in those rooms is that we were able to organize celebrations like of the 4th of July, like of Thanksgiving, like of Christmas and so on. These holidays were very tough to handle because it looked like, again, a lifetime up there. 5 years, 10 years would have been easy to handle. I mean, it was not easy to handle, but it would a lot easier than dying up there was what it looked like, never seeing your family again. So we had one guy from Louisiana who was a lineman for the LSU University. When I used to talk 15, 20 years ago, I used to have to explain that LSU was a good football power, but now people understand that they are. They're one of the, you know, the Southeast Conference and so on, and they're a serious football team. He was a lineman for them. He was a big, powerful man, and his name was Larry Barbe. And Larry Barbe had never got by. After 2.5 years, our commanders, because they offered everybody, we were allowed to write a letter to our wife and get a letter about once every month, once every 2 or 3 months. So we were all getting letters, but Larry Barbe wasn't. And Larry Barbe had 5 kids, and he never got a letter, and he never was allowed to write a letter. And we're convinced it was because of the way Larry Barbe looked. You know how you have John Wayne looks like a pretty tough guy, right? Well, Larry Barbe made him look like a fairy, okay? That's how Larry Barbe looked. And most people, when they smile, you know, they look pretty nice, pretty pleasant. You know, you're not really worried about them when they're smiling at you. But not Larry Barbe. When he smiled, he looked like he was going to eat you. It was the most crooked smile you ever want to see in your life. But he was the gentlest man you ever want to see in his life, because it's like, you know, we all learn how to be good as we get older and older, because God's very good at teaching us. So Larry Barbe learned at an early age that he had to be very, very nice. Never raise his voice. Never be upset. Because if he wasn't, no other human being on earth would ever talk to him or come near to him. That's how rough this guy looked. But he had a wonderful wife. His wife, we thought his wife had left him, but she hadn't. They lived a wonderful life together. From tremendous number of grandchildren. He was a Catholic from Louisiana, one of the Cajun Catholics down there. On the holidays, we all had Larry sing his song about his son. We all had children. I had 2 children, but a lot of the guys had 3, 4, 5, 6 children. So he would sing his song about his family, and we would all, because we're all gluttons for punishment, we'd all listen to it and have him sing his song every holiday. So I just wanted to go through that song. Larry would sing. "I asked a little boy to call his daddy. He said he couldn't and sighed. And when I asked him what was wrong, here's what the boy replied. My daddy is only a picture in a frame that hangs on the wall. Each day I talk to my daddy, but he never talks at all. I tell him all of my secrets and all of my little plans, and from the way he smiles at me, I know he understands. The angels took Daddy to heaven when I was just going on 3, but I'll bet they never told him how sad and lonely we'd be. I try to cheer up my mommy when the tears roll down her face. My daddy is only a picture, but I'm trying to take his place. Okay. Now, you had 45 guys in our cell. You didn't have a dry face. Everybody was crying every time Larry sang that song, and yet the next holiday we'd have him sing it again, because he just sang it so beautifully with such feeling, and we all were in that position, and we all just loved to hear him sing that song. And when we came back at a couple of the reunions, we had Larry sing that song that we were all, everything like that. That's like everybody here, just about, you know, away from your family like that, unexpectedly, and we're all together. And it looks like we're never going back to the States. We're never going back to our family, ever. That's what it looked like up there. Okay, now, the forgiveness story that I had was a story of heroic love, just like there was a story of heroic love of my wife, who waited 6 years for me up there without any word for 2.5 years, worked with all the people, went to Paris to try to raise awareness of the plight that we were in, and she worked all that time. She was faithful and had 5 more kids after I got back home. She's had 7 natural children. We've adopted an 8th. So that was a story of heroic love. My brother graduated the Air Force Academy 3 years after me. He volunteered for Vietnam, didn't have to go. He volunteered to come get me out. He told my family he's not coming home till I came home. If I never came home, he's never coming home. He was tour after tour over there, over 500 combat missions. He was shot down in one of the last missions of the war over Hanoi in a B-52, shot down in flames. And he was in the bombers that bombed us out of there on Christmas of 72. We were released early in 73 because of that bombing raid. My brother accomplished his mission. Lance Saijon, the POW I told you about, it was beaten to death because he wouldn't give him anything but name, rank, service number, date of birth, and took 3 or 4 terrible beatings every day, and he had been in the jungle for 45 days. He was down to about 60 or 80 pounds when he started, and they just simply beat him to death. My heroic love was a forgiveness story. To forgive somebody, you gotta love them. That's why we're told to forgive. That's why Jesus' example, forgive, forgive. You gotta love to forgive. And the harder it is to forgive, the greater love you have to demonstrate. I had to demonstrate great love with the forgiveness I had, because it was very hard to forgive these people. Most of the time we fail. Instead, we do the selfish thing, which is to hate the person who hurt us, or ignore the person who hurt us, or whatever. That's all part of hatred. Okay? Can't do that. You got 4 kinds of forgiveness he trained us in. You got to ask God for forgiveness. If you know you hurt somebody, then you better ask them to forgive you. Make it easy for them. If you fairly hurt somebody, you want to also forgive anybody that hurt you and forgive yourself. Start life from right this moment. You can't change a past. Let God handle a future. Just live the love in a moment. Live the moment is the right answer down here. Okay, I've got a picture here on the slide of Robbie Reisner when he after he came home, he became a general. And after 10 years after he came home, one of the people asked him at one of the talks he was given, What did you think when you were walking to the torture room and you heard everybody start out with the Battle Hymn of the Republic again? And he said, I felt 9 feet tall. And so they, Ross Perot commissioned a 9 foot tall bronze of him, and it's at the Air Force Academy now. He didn't go to the Academy, but that's where he wanted it. And so his statue is out there as an indication of a God-based resistance. And a leader that leads with righteousness and holiness is a great leader. Why? Why does this always work? You say, oh, it doesn't always work. Oh, yeah, it always works. It always works. George Washington on his knees, 9 to 10 o'clock, every night, according to his aide that was with him for 17 years. Every night, 9 o'clock, on his knees, Bible on a chair in front of him, candle on the chair, on his knees for an hour, reading that Bible. George Washington, every morning, 4 o'clock in the morning, 4 to 5, on his knees, Bible on the chair, candle on the chair, reading the Bible an hour in the morning. Morning and night, okay? Eisenhower, who I consider is the greatest or the second greatest president of the United States, greatest combat commander of all time, no doubt of that, the president that set up the winning Cold War military in the 50s and 60s, all kinds of other things. The Code of Conduct came from Eisenhower in 1954. I've got a signed copy of the Code of Conduct from Eisenhower, which got us, let us beat the communist prison camp. The interstate highway system is from Eisenhower. He saw what the Germans were doing with the Autobahn system, and he duplicated it countrywide in the United States. Eisenhower, always a smile on his face, always joyful. How does he do that? How does he do that? Eisenhower had the entire Bible, Old and New Testament, memorized by the age of 16. Eisenhower, President Eisenhower of the United States, okay? A righteous leader is what you want. An unrighteous leader, he's gonna screw up like crazy. But somebody who's trusting in God is gonna have his decisions blessed. That's true for the president, that's true for any politician, that's true for the father of every family, that's true for every business leader, that's true for everyone on this earth. That's the way the earth works. If you're so prideful that you think that things are up to you, you're gonna fail over and over again until you die. If you realize that everything's up to God and you're okay with that and just accept Him, you'll be blessed over and over until you die. Okay, that's my time. Thank you very, very much for your attention. It's been a real pleasure talking to you.